Good morning.
Good morning.
This is the fourth Sunday of Easter, and in our gospel, we will be hearing about Jesus as the Good Shepherd.
Thank you.
Blessed
be the Holy Trinity, one God, the wellspring of our grace, our Easter, and our joy.
Amen.
Look, here is water. Immersed in the promises of baptism, let us give thanks for what God has done for us. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your voice thundered over the deep, and water became the essence of life. Adam and Eve beheld Eden's verdant rivers. The ark carried your creation through the flood into a new day. Miriam led the dancing as your people passed through the sea into freedom's land. In a desert pool, the Ethiopian official entered your boundless baptismal life. Look, here is water. At the river, your beloved son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By the baptism of Jesus' death and resurrection, you open the floodgates of your reconciling love, freeing us to live as Easter people. We rejoice with glad hearts, giving all honor and praise to you. Through the risen Christ, our source of living water, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Look, here is water.
Here is the water of life. Hallelujah.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
And for the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Christ, good shepherd of the sheep, you seek the lost and guide us into your fold. Feed us, and we shall be satisfied. Heal us, and we shall be whole. Make us one with you, for you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Leave it all behind. Leave it all.
The first reading is taken from the book of Acts, chapter 4. Peter and John had been arrested the previous day because they were proclaiming the news of the resurrection to the people. In today's reading, Peter is filled with the Holy Spirit so that he can proclaim salvation in Jesus' name to the religious authorities. The next day, the rulers, elders, and scribes assembled in Jerusalem with Annas the high priest, Caiaphas, John and Alexander, and all who were of the high priestly family. When they had made the prisoners stand in their midst, they inquired, "By what power or by what means did you do this?" Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers of the people and elders, if we are questioned today because of a good deed done to someone who was sick, and are asked how this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel, that this man is standing before you in good health by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders. It has become the cornerstone. There is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among mortals by which we must be saved." Word of God, word of life. We'll now read Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want.
The Lord makes me lie down in green pastures and leads me beside still waters.
You restore my soul, O Lord, and guide me along right pathways for your name's sake.
Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup is running over.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
The second reading is taken from 1 John chapter 3. Jesus' death on our behalf is the clearest demonstration of divine love. This is the very love we share with others, not just through our words, but especially through our deeds. In sharing such love, we fulfill God's commandments. We know love by this, that Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for one another. How does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees a brother or sister in need and yet refuses to help? Little children, let us love, not in word or speech, but in truth and action. And by this we will know that we are from the truth, and will reassure our hearts before him whenever our hearts condemn us. For God is greater than our hearts, and he knows everything. Beloved, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have boldness before God, and we receive from him whatever we ask, because we obey his commandments and do what pleases him. And this is his commandment, that we should believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as he has commanded us. All who obey this commandment abide in him, and he abides in them. And by this we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit that he has given us. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to John, the 10th chapter. Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand, who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. I have received this command from my Father, the Gospel of the Lord. Some of you know that I attended a conference in the last week. A conference about Seminex. Now you may ask yourself two questions. Question one, what is Seminex? And question two, what has this weird Seminex to do with our gospel text about the Good Shepherd? I promise I will answer these questions step by step. First, let me explain what Seminex is. Seminex has to do with the Concordia Missouri Synod Seminary. In 1974, exactly 50 years ago, Most students and professors left their seminary, which was called Concordia Seminary, located in St. Louis, and founded Seminarians in Exile, short Seminacs. The seminary in exile was formed due to the ongoing fundamentalist-modernist controversy that was dividing Protestant churches in the United States, an issue where foundational disagreement on the authority of Scripture and the role of Christianity. During the 1960s, many clergy and members of the Missouri Synod grew concerned about the direction of education at their flagship seminary, Concordia Seminary in St. Louis, Missouri. In short, professors began to teach too progressive for the Missouri Synod. After attempts at compromise failed, the Missouri Synod president Jacob Preuss moved to suspend the seminary president John Titian. This suspension led to a walkout of most faculty and students and the formation of Seminacs. Seminacs existed as an institution until its last graduating class of 1983 and was formally dissolved and merged with Lutheran School of Theology at Chicago in 1987. Concordia Seminary quickly rebuilt and by the late 1970s had regained its place as one of the largest Lutheran seminaries in the United States. As the students and most of their professors walked out of their seminary, everybody was carrying a cross. These crosses were made out of cheap wood and were signed with the name of the person carrying the cross. After the walkout, they put it into the ground of the seminarian's garden, which now looked like a cemetery. And that's what it was. Concordia Seminary was that. Their education was that. Their future was that. So they had not picked the symbol of the cross randomly. They picked the cross as a symbol of grief, like the family and friends of Jesus grieved at the cross, like we are grieving on Good Friday. But the cross is not also a symbol of grief. It is also a symbol of a new beginning, a symbol for Easter, for the resurrection of our Lord, a symbol that their past or our faith will not end with the walk out of the seminary building, a symbol that there is hope for the students and the professors and also for us. And now to question two. What does this have to do with our gospel text for today's Sunday and with Jesus as a good shepherd? We hear in today's gospel, I am the good shepherd. Before I connect Seminacs with the good shepherd, we have to talk about what a good shepherd is. We find the answer in the text as Jesus explains, the good shepherd gives, lays down their life for the sheep. Which raises some more questions for me. Question one, what exactly is life? And question two, what does it mean to give it or to lay it down? I mean, we are hearing it three times in the gospel that the life is laid down. Let's consider question one. If you were asked, how would you define life in one sentence? According to Jacques Lacan, there was a French doctor from the 1800s named Marie-Françoise Xavier Blichard defined life in the sentence, life is the totality of forces that resist death. I think this is a simple yet profound understanding that life is all the things that resist, oppose, defy the loss of life. And in the original Greek, this word for life, psyche, implies breath, the breath of life, breath flowing spirit and the totality of all forces that resist death, loss of life. When you think about the creation report, it may come to your mind that God was giving Adam the breath of life. And I was also wondering, what does it mean to give it, to lay it down? And sometimes it helps me to check the Greek original biblical translation of the New Testament. The Greek word for to lay down means to be in control. God is in control of our lives. He does not abandon us. We can trust him. We also encounter the word again in verse 18. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. So what does it mean for God to give, to lay down his own life for the sheep? It means that Christ says to the sheep, I trust you, I entrust you, my life to you, I lay it down before you, for you. I think a shepherd like this is exactly what they needed in this moment as they left their seminary building. But what do we imagine a shepherd to be? For the students, leaving the seminary meant that they were embarking on an uncertain future. Even more, they were saying goodbye to a certain and secure future. Yes, they had lost everything, except for one thing, their faith in Jesus Christ. Because it was their faith in Jesus Christ that made them seminarians. The conference enabled me to have conversations with these brave students who 50 years ago decided for their faith and against an institution. And one thing came out very clearly. Their faith was the most important thing for them. Their faith was what they never lost. Their faith accompanied and guided them. Just as a shepherd leads his flock, Jesus accompanied them in these difficult hours when they left the campus, but also when they returned. Why would students go back after the walkout, which is tantamount to a major schism? You may be asking yourself now. It is simple. The students lived on campus. Their apartments, their beds, their clothes, their valuables, everything was on campus. A difficult path, I think. And probably even more difficult than leaving the campus. They return ostracized, just like the disciples of Jesus, who returned to the city after the crucifixion. They stood there as idiots. The disciples and the students. The disciples and the students were afraid of the future. But Jesus, the good shepherd, did not abandon them. He showed himself to the disciples as the risen one. And the seminary students are not abandoned by God either. For the Lutheran seminary in Chicago has taken them in and given them a new home. But still, after founding a new home in another seminary, they were sticking to their identity as seminary students and not as students of the Lutheran School of Theology at Chicago. They decided to name the seminary Seminex, now Christ Seminary, because it was Jesus Christ who went the path together with them. The people at the conference told me that they wouldn't wish this experience on anyone, but also that they would never want to miss this experience, because this experience of the walkout has only made them stronger in their faith. And we? What can we learn out of both stories? Out of the gospel text as also out of the seminary story. I say we can learn to trust and to have hope because we are not alone. Jesus Christ is the good shepherd who walks with us every path. We can trust that God is the one who makes everything new, that Jesus is the one who resurrected from the dead. We can hope that there will be a happy end, and we can trust that God never leaves us alone, even not in the darkest hours of our life. Amen. Let us confess our faith together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things are made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. In accordance with the scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory, judge the living and the dead. His kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who is the Father and the Son worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Rejoicing that Jesus is risen and love has triumphed over fear, let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need of good news. Shepherding God, gather your church whenever we wander from you and one another. Empower our church and ministries around the world to worship and serve alongside global companions as equal partners and co-workers in the gospel. God of praise. Nurturing God, preserve the health of biomass and ecosystems. Inspire scientists, researchers, conservation organizations, and all people entrusted with the task of caring for creation, that we may be better stewards of the world around us. God of Christ. Almighty God, lead nations and communities to share resources, cooperate in solving conflicts, and listen to the wisdom of indigenous peoples. Help all those with power to share it and to use such power for good. God of grace. Loving God, protect the very young and the very old, those living without housing, victims of domestic abuse, and all who live with chronic illness or compromised immune systems. Guide communities to actively care for people who are vulnerable. God of grace. Gracious God, help these and all communities of faith to listen for your voice. Call us away from things that distract us from following you. Invite us to more deeply love and serve people who are lonely, isolated, and on the margins. God of grace. Please join me. For Griffith Lutheran Church, help us to use our many blessings to grow our church, to make a difference in our lives and in our community. Help us that we may grow Christ-centered relationships in our communities through love and service. God of grace. Living God, we give thanks for our ancestors in faith. Strengthen us to share the good news in our own day. God of grace.
God of learning, our partners in prayer focus this week is for professors, teachers, and college students as they finish their semester of education. Many will be graduating and moving on to their chosen careers, and many will be taking a break for the summer. Be with all of them. Bless them and give them peace and rest as they move forward. We especially ask you to bless Miriam as she finishes her semester of learning. God of grace.
Hear our prayer.
Into your hands, most gracious, merciful God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your abiding love, through Jesus Christ, our resurrected and living Lord.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, ruler of heaven and earth. Day by day you shower us with blessings. As you have raised us to new life in Christ, give us glad and generous hearts, ready to praise you and to respond to those in need. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should, at all times and in all places, give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death, and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Thanks, Father, through Jesus Christ, your beloved Son, whom you sent in this end of the ages to save and redeem us and to proclaim to us your will. He is your Word, inseparable from you, through whom you created all things and in whom you take delight. He is your Word, sent from heaven to a virgin's womb. He there took on our nature and our lot and was shown forth as your Son, born of the Holy Spirit and of the Virgin Mary. He, our Lord Jesus, fulfilled all your will and won for you a holy people. He stretched out his hands in suffering in order to free from suffering those who trust you. He is the one who handed over to a death he freely accepted in order to destroy death, to break the bonds of the evil one, to crush hell underfoot, to give light to the righteous, to establish his covenant, and to show forth the resurrection. Taking bread and giving thanks to you, said, take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup and gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, this cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. Remembering then his death and resurrection, we take this bread and cup, giving you thanks that you have made us worthy to stand before you and to serve you as your priestly people. Send your Spirit upon these gifts of your church. Gather into one all who share this bread and wine. Fill us with your Holy Spirit to establish our faith and truth, that we may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ, through whom all glory and honor are yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, both now and forever. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The risen Christ is made known to us in the breaking of the bread. Come eat at God's table.
Thank you.
For those of you remaining in the pew and those of you on Facebook, the body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Life-giving God, in the mystery of Christ's resurrection, you send light to conquer darkness, water to give new life, and the bread of life to nourish your people. Send us forth as witnesses to your Son's resurrection, that we may show your glory to all the world. Through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Please look at the bulletin for announcements. Our mission this month is Grace Beyond Borders. And as you know, our rummage sale is April 26 and 27. Fellowship is in need of help starting tomorrow, placing priced items on the tables, and Friday and Saturday at the sale. Even an hour is of help. Please see Joe Ellen. Please stand. By the way, thank you all for having birthdays in April. These flowers are in your honor. And they're beautiful, aren't they? I've been admiring them all morning. Alleluia, Christ is risen. The God of resurrection power, the Christ of unending joy, and the Spirit of Easter hope bless you now and always.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Go in peace, rejoice, and be glad.